in this room. I don't know who it is, but I got good news for you. That your hunger, that your thirst has gotten the attention of the Almighty God. And tonight is your night of victory. Tonight is your night for a revival to start inside of your own life. Tonight is a night for great breakthrough in your family, great breakthrough in your finances, great breakthrough in your ministry. Come on. Your expectation, your hunger, your thirst for more of God pulls down miracles from heaven that have been already assigned to you and your family. Call them down. Call them down from heaven. Come on, the windows of heaven are open over us today. God has no limits. If you believe that, just give God a huge, loud praise right now. If you are hungry for a miracle tonight, come on. Father, we just thank you. We give you all the honor, God, all the glory. God, we are hungry for you, God. God, we are thirsty for you. We want more of you in our lives, God. God, we need you in every aspect of our life. In every circumstance, Jesus, we need you. And God, I pray for every person in this room that tonight that they would receive the miracle that they're calling out for, the miracle that they're so desperate for. Come on, I agree with them, God. And where you said, God, in your word, that if two or three or more are gathered, are in agreement, God, and that you are in the midst, God. So you're here right now in the midst, God, because we agree and we say, bring us down the miracles tonight. Not tomorrow, not next week, but tonight, God, we want you to invade us, transform us, and change us. This is a special night, God. Jesus, you've done so much, and you're barely getting started. Come on, someone needs to hear that. He's just getting started in your life. You haven't seen anything yet. God, let us taste how good you are tonight. Set people free tonight. Heal us tonight, and through the word of God and through the power of the Holy Spirit, transform our minds, God. In Jesus' name we pray. If you all agree with me, just give a shout, amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Well, you may be seated. Thank you, worship team. Great job. You guys can give a hand for our worship team. I am so happy to be here, man. How are you guys doing? Yeah, man, this is amazing to be here. All the way from Compton. I had to fly all the way here. No, just kidding. Man, I'm excited to be here with you guys. And, you know, we've been doing a great work in LA. We're barely getting started. Our building's already too small. On Sunday, we had over 200 people on Sunday service. We have a 9 and 11, and if we don't get a new building soon, we might have to have a 1 p.m. I don't know what's happening, but God is moving. People are getting saved and delivered. They're being discipled, and, you know, I'm just excited to be here with you guys tonight. I don't know if you guys remember, but I told you I was going to write a book, and I ended up writing it. It's called Breaking the Chains of Depression, A Journey to Wholeness. And I made this book specifically for people who are battling depression, suicide. The first chapter talks about me battling suicide and how I overcame it. But after that, it's practical steps to actually help you overcome depression. Like, practical things. There's a chapter on forgiveness. There's a chapter on after you got delivered and healed from through this process, that I'm going to help you write out goals for your life now, because you need to get a new vision, because the old depressed you can't come to your future anymore. Like, it's some practical things. I even have, like, a little workout plan in here. I ain't gonna lie. Like, a little workout plan in here. It's just amazing. And I created it, too, so you could hand it to anybody. And this, and it ain't, like, no long, big old Harry Potter book, you know, or, like, the Bible. I don't think if you're depressed, you want to read that, you know. So it's short and to the point. We're going to sell these in the foyer after. But I want to give one away. Is there anyone battling depression right now that would say, I want this? All right, let's go. Let's get it. Be free in Jesus' name. Be healed too. Come on. Man, I'm sorry. I'm already. I just want to honor Pastor Marco, Pastor Lisa. Man, give a hand for Pastor Marco and Pastor Lisa. Some generals, and also Pastor Christian and Pastor Yesenia, our campus pastors here at the Hallmark. Yeah. Man, it's just a pleasure to be here with you guys, and how many of you are enjoying our 30-day growth challenge? How many are feeling a little challenged? That's good. That's what's supposed to happen. But I want to continue the teaching in James, and in the book of James so far in chapter 2, what we've been learning is that James is addressing some people and the Jews. And what he's saying, though, he's addressing some sin in them. And what he's doing is confronting their sin of favoritism. Did you know that that is a sin? Like, that's some stuff that I don't think many of us thought is a sin. Like, you favorite. And what he was talking about was you're treating a person that is rich more valuable than a homeless person. And James is calling them out on that sin, and he's letting them know that that's fault, that's not good. And also, because they're doing that, they're breaking the law. So this is James. He's bold. I feel like he'd probably be like Pastor Marco vibe low-key. Like, he's just bold, and he's straight. But he's letting them know, and he's reminding them of the royal law, which is to love your neighbor. And so I have the privilege to go into verse 10 and verse 11. So if you could open up your Bibles or on your apps, go to chapter 2, James 2, verse 10 through 11. And we're going to just break that down. And I want to just show you some takeaways that I got as I was studying this verse. James 2, 10 through 11, for the person who keeps all of the laws except one is as guilty as a person who has broken all of God's laws. For the same God who said, you must not commit adultery, also said, you must not murder. So if you murder someone but do not commit adultery, you have still broken the law. Four takeaways from James 2, 10 and 11. Number one is this. Don't downplay the sin that you're playing with. Don't downplay. I think we have a tendency sometimes to make one sin bigger than the other. We have a tendency sometimes that we could get to a point where we're justifying our sin because we don't think it's as big as a sin as someone else, that the sin that they're committing. Or to you, that's not a big deal. That's sin. It's not a big deal. I just, you know, it's not that big of a deal. I just, you know, I sleep around sometimes. You're going to get help today. James helps us avoid picking and choosing which of Jesus' teachings we're going to follow and which ones we're going to disregard. He's helping us and protecting us from getting to a place where we'll say stuff like this. I follow this one, but I don't agree with that one, so I'm not going to follow it. I'll obey the command of murder, but the command of adultery, I'm going to disregard that one. Have you ever been in that position? Man, I know. Come on, raise them hands. Yo. I've been in that position before. And if you're going to continue to be in that position, let's just say you're in that position right now, the sad thing is this, you'll get to a place where you not only justify the sin that you're doing, but you could get to a point where you start to share it and teach it with other people, and now you have a following, and now you have people that are doing the same sin as you and justifying it like it's okay. Like, we're Christian, we do certain, we don't drink, but, you know, I gotta get a little bit of weed sometimes. I'm okay with not robbing somebody, but I'll allow gossip to be in my heart. If you want to get away and experience real freedom from this, the first thing that you have to do is confess your sin. Like, I've always been the type to just, is it a sin? Like, I don't want to fight and argue that this is not a sin. It's okay for me to do it. I just make things simple. Like, okay, is it a sin? Okay, then I don't need it. Some of us, we fight so hard to be right about a sin that you're involved in. But get back to the place where you could focus on God and realize at the end of the day, all I really need is God. And if God is telling me this is not for me, it's not good for me, I do not need it. And this is the other thing. If something has a hold on me to where I can't just give it up, I don't want that. If it's hard for you to just surrender that relationship or to surrender that sin or that thing that God told you to surrender, you need to surrender it like tonight. Proverbs 28:13, people who conceal their sins will not prosper, but if they confess and turn from them, they will receive mercy. Don't hide your sin. Don't conceal it. Expose it. God, search me. Search my heart. Whatever is in me, God, that you do is sin, take it out of me, God. Expose it. Don't you want to be more like God? You're a child of God. You're a son of God. You're a daughter of the Most High God. Chase that rather than pleasing your flesh. And some of us, we might feel like, well, I don't really do, like, things that you see as obvious sins. But yet you can hold unforgiveness towards somebody in your household. Or you could be very short and rude and mean to people. Do you know that that's sin as well? It's still sin. Colossians 3:8-9. But now is the time. Say now. Say tonight. It says now is the time to get rid of anger, rage, malicious behavior, slander, and dirty language. Don't lie to each other, for you have stripped off your old sinful nature and all its wicked deeds. There's no shame in just saying, God, I have these sins. I have these things going on in my life, and I need to lay them down and give them to you. We're not going to knock you for that. And sometimes we stay in bondage because we're trying to please people around us. Sometimes we're hiding the sin inside of us. There's sin in your closet, and it's because you don't want to expose it because you're afraid of how people are going to look at you. Do you want to wait until your sin exposes you, or do you want to expose yourself and say, God, I need you. God, I'm filthy. God, come clean me. God, set me free tonight. God loves you and he's merciful. He wants to set you free. But you got to acknowledge the sin in your life and call it what it is. My second takeaway is we're all in the same boat, so be merciful. We're all in the same boat. So let's have a little more mercy for each other, more grace for each other, more love for each other. Because you could look at the person to the left and to the right, and just because they had this obvious sin that they fell in, Lord knows the sin that you fell in. I'm telling you, this will make your whole life happy. Like, you'll be good. When you just don't focus on, oh, what did she do? Oh, what? Cheese man, like, looking at everyone's social media and judging everybody. This is going to help you to really enjoy your life. Give mercy to people. You and I both know you ain't got it all together. You know that. I know that about you. I don't even know you. Your wife knows that. Your family knows that. You got to be real with yourself. And this is the other thing. When we're judging people and we're not willing to give out mercy when they mess up, you become a hypocrite. Because you sure do want mercy when you get found out. And not just from people, I'm talking about from God Almighty. We're like, God, please, Lord, please. Like, we drop to our knees quick for God when we're in a certain situation and we need the mercy of God on our lives. Now, how many laws do you think that you have to break? We have all these laws in California. How many of these laws do you think that you have to break in order to be a lawbreaker? One. Let me help you there. Uno, one. One law. One law. We have many laws, but no matter what law you broke, just breaking one law makes you a lawbreaker. Matthew 7:2. For you will be treated as you treat others. Some of y'all do not understand why you get treated certain ways. I'm just saying, you might want to just look at your life and your relationships and how you interact with other people and start to just look, God, hold on, is there something off right there? Because I'm getting all of this heat from everyone else and I'm getting mistreated left and right. But let me look at how I'm treating the people around me. It's the Bible, it's true. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard that you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. And we may have the tendency to give a small measure of mercy to somebody, like just a little teaspoon, especially in marriage. Woo! Where are married couples at? Wave your hands. Yeah, come on, be happy. Come on, what's wrong with you? No, yeah, sign up for the marriage conference coming up. Yeah, sometimes this is the thing. Giving out that mercy of that teaspoon because they did something to you. But when you desire mercy, you want it in a whole U-Haul truck. Like, you want it coming to you like, man, they better ship that in like a whole plane. Like, I need all the mercy I could get. Give what you want. If you want mercy, a lot of mercy given to you, don't be handing out no teaspoons. And some of you guys are thinking, well, they do this to me all the time. How much mercy do I have to have? Go on YouTube and listen to our forgiveness series. 70 times 7. Forgive them and give them mercy, okay? I forgive them and I let her go. Do you guys remember a story in the Bible where there's a story where David, he fell into sexual immorality and he slept with a girl named Bathsheba. And I want to just read 2 Samuel 12:1 through 7. It says, so the Lord sent Nathan the prophet to tell David this story. There were two men in a certain town. One was rich and one was poor. The rich man owned a great many sheep and cattle. The poor man owned nothing but one little lamb he had bought. He raised that little lamb and grew up with his children. It ate from the man's own plate and drank from his cup. He cuddled it in his arms like a baby daughter. Verse 4, one day a guest arrived at the home of the rich man, but instead of killing an animal from his own flock or herd, he took the poor man's lamb and killed it and prepared it for his guest. So David just committed a sin with Bathsheba. The prophet Nathan pulls up and shares this story with him. And verse 5, this is David's response. David was furious. As surely as the Lord lives, he vowed, any man who could do such a thing deserves to die. He must repay four lambs so the poor man for the one he stole and for having no pity. Then Nathan said to David, you are that man. And verse 13, David responds, then David confessed to Nathan, I have sinned against the Lord. Nathan replied, yes, but the Lord has forgiven you and you won't die for this sin. David was judging himself by this story. He didn't even realize it. David needed mercy because he fell into sexual immorality. And the goodness and the greatness of God, the love of God, because David acknowledged his sin, David was forgiven of his sin. Can I tell you, no matter what the sin is, no matter where you're at right now, please confess it, acknowledge it, ask God to forgive you of your sin. And you know what's going to happen? He's going to say, you're forgiven. Come on. Some of us, we need that forgiveness and that mercy. We don't even know why things are the way they are in our life right now. Because you're concealing some things that God's saying, just give this to me. God wants to forgive you and he wants to release mercy on your life. Jesus said, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. If you go around judging people and you show no mercy, then when it comes for your time to be judged, you will be shown no mercy. And a lot of us in the heat of the moment, we don't even realize it. That's why you have to, after you give your life to Jesus, you have to graduate and you have to start to mature in Christ. You can't just keep pulling the card. Oh, I didn't know better, my bad. I just being rude, you know, flipping that guy off on the car and getting in this fight. Like, no, be merciful to people. My third takeaway is this. Oh, I didn't even tell you the sermon title, huh? You guys want it? Here it is. It's a little late, but hey. The title of the sermon is, I Need a Savior. Because when I'm reading this portion of scripture, as I'm studying these two verses, I'm like, this just makes me realize, like, how much more, like, I need Jesus. I need God so bad every single day. So I need a Savior. Number three, we all need a Savior, and his name is Jesus. In Jesus, I have been set free. I'm free from the law of Moses. The law of Moses cannot save me, did not save me. I was saved by putting my faith in Jesus Christ. That's how I am saved. So my faith in Jesus has brought me under a new law, the law of freedom. And in this law of freedom, I now do things not to be saved. I do things because I am saved. Does that make sense? God has poured his standards. God has poured his desires inside of my heart. And I desire to please God. Not because I'm trying to work my way to heaven still. Because I am saved. I'm a child of God and I want to please my Father. I'm not trying to do these things to be saved. Don't get it twisted. You could do all the ministry you want. That ain't going to save you. You could do all these religious practices, and you could be praying for 50 hours, I don't know, like straight in tongues. Like, that's not going to save you. I love doing the works of the Lord. But I'm not doing it from a place of trying to earn salvation. I understand that God has a plan for my life. I understand the call of God on my life. I understand that God has some standards for us to live by. That's why I do these things. Galatians 2:16. Yet we know that a person is made right with God by faith in Jesus Christ, not by obeying the law. And we have believed in Christ Jesus so that we might be made right with God because of our faith in Christ, not because we have obeyed the law. For no one will ever be made right with God by obeying the law. No one. You can't do enough things to get saved. You can't read enough. You can't pray enough. You can't show up to church enough and that be the reason why you have eternal salvation. Because I think sometimes we get it messed up and we think, because I didn't do this today for the Lord, I don't think I'm saved. That's a lie. If you have given your life to Jesus Christ and you've confessed your sins to Jesus, if you believe that he's the Son of God, that he died for your sins and on the third day he rose from the dead and he's going to be coming back for his church. If you believe in Jesus and you gave him your life, you're saved. That's some good news for someone because that just lifted a weight off of some of you because you've been developing to become religious. And God's saying, let's get that religion off of you. We're not doing things because we should or we have to. We're doing things because we're children of God. We have his DNA. He's my dad. I have his DNA inside of me. So the things that he's about, I just happen to start becoming about those things because I love him, because I want him, because he lives in me through his Holy Spirit. Every single one of us falls short of God's standards. We cannot do it on our own. There's just no way you're going to get to a place where you can do it on your own. We need God's help. You need God. Romans 3:23, for everyone has sinned. Every single one of us. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the free gift, someone say free gift, of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. Just one sin positions us for eternal punishment. But through putting your faith in Jesus, by choosing to surrender your life to Jesus, he will save you. He will save you. Not your works, not your pastor, not anybody else. He will save you. My fourth takeaway is this. To live in a way that pleases God, we need the Holy Spirit. To live in a way that pleases God. Come on, it's not easy. You know, and if you've been there, you know. You need the Holy Spirit's help to live for Jesus. There's a reason why he told the disciples to go and get filled with the Holy Spirit. James 2:12, it says, so whatever you say or whatever you do, remember that you will be judged by the law that sets you free. We are under the law of freedom, right? And it has freedom, but it's still a law that must be obeyed that we will be judged by. Now, I know some of you might be thinking, like, I thought my judgment was over. I thought I was forgiven of my sins. You are. But in the Bible, it talks about, I'm going to go over in the verse, but we will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. What is the law of freedom really, like, what am I talking about? It's moral and ethical principles that are expected for us to live as followers of Christ. The idea is that it emphasizes on freedom from the burden of sin and the law. So as believers, if you're a believer, we are still called to live according to a higher moral standard. It's not like I give my life to Jesus and everything's a stamp of grace on it. There's still a life that he desires me to live. There's two judgments. The first judgment is in Revelation 20, 11 through 15. It talks about a final judgment where all people have died will stand before God. And the book of life will be opened. You may have heard of the book of life. And if someone's name is not in that book, they're then separated from God forever, symbolized as being cast into a lake of fire. The second judgment, this judgment is associated with the rewards for believers based on their actions rather than punishment. It's based on 2 Corinthians 5:10, which talks about everyone will appear before the judgment seat of Christ. This is a judgment of what believers did during their lives and how they'll be rewarded in heaven. So there's some judgment that we will still face as believers. Some of us didn't know that. But as a believer, my sins that I've confessed to Jesus, I'm not going to be judged for that. Where you spend eternity is based on your response to Jesus and the cross. Did you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior? But how you spend eternity comes down to how you lived your life as a believer and fulfilled your purpose. Yeah, I didn't know that. I'm learning with you. We need the Holy Spirit. Someone say, we need the Holy Spirit. Not just to preach the gospel, but to live a life that pleases the Lord and to produce fruits of the Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit. You can't be the dad that God has called you to be on your own. You can't be that mother or that father that God's called you to be or that ministry leader that God has called you to be without the Holy Spirit. You're not that smart. You're not that strong. You need God. Galatians 5, 22 and 23, but the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There's no law against these things. It's the Holy Spirit that will produce that in your life. He's going to help you live according to God's standards. He's going to help you fulfill the Great Commission. There's forgiveness for your sins tonight. There's mercy for you tonight. Tonight, one of the things that God was showing me is he wants to rescue some people. The title of my message, I said it a little bit ago, but it's, I need a Savior. But I need you to really understand, do you realize that you need a Savior? Do you realize that you need some rescuing? Ephesians 1:7, and the worship team could come up. He is so rich in kindness and grace that he purchased our freedom with the blood of his son and forgave our sins. There's an abundance of kindness for you right now. I know maybe you are not feeling it. I know maybe some of us might be in a place where we don't feel loved or we don't feel motivated by anybody around us. We don't feel encouraged. Whatever the case may be, you might feel down and out and depressed. You might feel hopeless. You might even be suicidal. But the good news is that God's love, there's a lot of it, there's more than enough just for you. He wants you. He wants to forgive you of your sins. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to save you. We're going to let the Holy Spirit move in a little bit. And y'all are going to get a touch from God. How many of you want a touch from God right now? Let's all stand up. Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. I want you to just look at your life right now. I want you to just close your eyes and reflect on you. Where are you at with God? What do you desire from God? What do you need to be forgiven of? Do you need salvation today? Are you lost today? Or have you already given your life to Jesus, but you found yourself and you realize today that there's some sins in your life that you've been downplaying. And you want to confess those sins to God. God is going to move on your behalf. Come on, it's over. Come on, the moment you want it, the moment you say, God, I want it, I'm ready, it's over. Come on, put your faith, begin to just ask God to save you. Begin to ask God to transform you, to set you free from that sin that you can't get out of your way. Maybe it keeps tripping you up over and over, and maybe you're just so tired of this sin that it even got you to a place where you want to just quit on things. God said, I'll take that from you tonight. But you cannot conceal things. And if you've ever concealed something, you know sometimes you'll try to act like you overcame it, or, oh yeah, I God knows that I struggle with this, but no, call it what it is. Call it sin and say, get out of my life. I don't want you anymore. I don't need you anymore. You've robbed me of enough things. I will no longer be stuck in this cycle of sin. I will no longer be justifying my sin. I want real freedom. I'm tired of a cycle. I desire transformation. I'm desperate for a move of God. Thank you, Lord. Come on, begin to pray to God. Wherever you're at, just start to pray. Start to pray. Start to talk to God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Come on. Call on God right now. Come on. He can do what I can't do. He can set you free right now. Ask God to forgive you of your sins right now. Come on. Confess those sins. I'm not asking you to come on the mic and share it. I'm asking you right where you're at right now, begin to just share your heart with God. Right where you're at, right in that seat, begin to just open up everything that you are and tell him the truth about where you're at. Tell him about the sins that you're concealing and release them to him. Release them to God. Come on. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Father, I just pray over every person, God, in this place. Give them eyes to see, God. I just pray and I release revelation in the name of Jesus. Reveal to them, God, things that have been hindering them. Reveal to them, God. Holy Spirit, move in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, begin to move and invade this place. Begin to move all throughout this room. Holy Spirit, begin to just shake us up. Begin to deliver us right now. Begin to set us free, God, from sin right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Those that are far from you, God, them just showing up to church today. God, your word says, draw near to me and I will draw near to you. Begin to come near to them right now. Begin to touch them right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Begin to overwhelm them with your presence of God. Yes, Lord. Begin to just ask God or lift up your hands in this place. And we're going to do a song right now. And as we're worshiping, look, some of you guys, if you have something in your pocket that you need to lay down on the stage right here, you're going to lay it down tonight. And some of us, it's an addiction. Some of us, I honestly, I don't know what it is, but I just, the Holy Spirit just put that on my heart. Like, whatever it is that you need to lay it down on this stage, and we're going to release it tonight. Come on. Demons are going to flee tonight. People are going to, their bodies are going to be healed tonight. I'm serious. Tonight is your night. Someone say, tonight is special. It's special because you're here. It's special because it's for you. It's for all of us. So as we're worshiping, and if you want to worship in the front, you feel like you need to come to the altar already before I make the altar call, you could already come. But if you need to lay something on the stage, you need to lay something on the stage. I want you to lay it on the stage. Whatever it is, it doesn't matter if it's a pipe. It doesn't matter what it is. Don't be ashamed. I mean, we've been there. I mean, you might be sitting next to someone that was a drug addict. Man, we don't care. We ain't judging you. We love you. Come on. Let's go. He already came and dropped something right now. If you need to drop something, come on, drop it right here. Jesus will set you free right now. As we're worshiping, come on, let's worship. Don't stop praying. Come on. Call down the miracle that you need. Come on. You need to be down here at this altar. There's space for you. If you're thinking about it, it's because you belong here. If you need prayer, I want you to run up this seat as fast. I want you to run out of your seat as fast as you can as fast as you can. I want you to run up to these altars. If you need a breakthrough and you need God to deliver you, you need Jesus to set you free, you need the presence of God to break the chains off of your life. Tonight is your night. Come on. You're not in this room by accident. You're not in here by accident. God has a plan. God has a plan for you. Father, I thank you for my brother. I pray right now in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, all addictions, I break you off of his life now. In the name of Jesus, every addiction, all abuse, spirit of abuse, I bind you. All abuse from childhood. All abuse from childhood. Go. Say, I forgive. And say, everyone, say, I forgive. And all the people that have abused you in your life, you're going to say, I forgive them. And you're going to let them go right now. Come on. In the name of Jesus, fill them up with your forgiveness, Lord. Let them feel your love right now. Love, love, love. Fire in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Rabasi. Jesus, forgive me of all my sins right now. In the name of Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to pray for some more people. Before I do, though, I want to give everyone the opportunity to give their life to Jesus and surrender their life. If you want to give your life to Jesus, you want to surrender your life to Jesus on count of three, I want you to lift up your hands. One, two, three. Lift up your hands if you want to surrender your life to Jesus. We got one over here. Two. We got three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Anybody else? Lift up your hands. 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Come on, 15. 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22, 23, 24. Come on, why am I counting? Because it matters to God. Every one of you matter to God. Come on. If you want to give your life to Jesus and you raise your hand, I want you to make sure you're up here in the front, because this is you surrendering your life to Jesus is a starting point. So if you raise your hand, run up here to the front if you're not already up here. Come on, give them a hand as they're coming down. Come on, church. Saving souls is what it's all about. Come on. Yes. I want you to pray with me. I want you to pray this prayer with me. And as you're praying this prayer, surrender your life to Jesus. If you guys could join us in prayer, just repeat after me. Say, Jesus, tonight I lay my life down to you. Set me free. Save me. I put my faith in Jesus Christ. I believe that you died for my sins, and on the third day you rose from the dead. Forgive me, God, of every sin. From this moment forward, I am a follower of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, I pray. Amen, amen. Would you guys give Jesus a hand? Come on. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you need prayer, come down to the front. I would love to pray with you guys. We love you. If you need healing, if you need deliverance, come down here. I would love to pray with you. We have a great team as well that would love to pray with you guys. God bless you guys. See you on Sunday, 9 a.m., 11 a.m., and 1 p.m. God bless you.